questions are asked or what fields. I'm going to go over the lab review sheet, which has been up on PAL under contents since the beginning of the semester. I have some stations set up from about here to about here for you to practice with, and I will give you the answers. I want you to at least try them first. I will go over a couple things on the board and show you some pictures. And of course, give you time to ask questions. Give you time to move it towards something that would be focused towards you. Now, a couple things. Remember, there's a lab midterm review sheet. And it also says that in your lab manual, page A13, which has been there, is another review sheet for this lab. The A13 page in your lab manual is a bit larger. The one I put up has focused it down. And, okay, let's start. The test is going to be 50 blank spaces. You're going to need to write in, there will be no word chart, the answer. They'll have parts A, B, or A, B, and C, maybe some won't. And we'll check the line number every few minutes or every 4 or 5. If you mess up your lines, I can't go through for one person and find out where you glitch. So I'll check every 3 or 4 times. I will go through a second time the PowerPoint, which is the test, and I'll also give you time to ask me questions. A couple of things about terms, terminology. I may ask for life groups or life forms. You give me an answer in relation to this. Is it a bacterium? Is it a fungal mold? Is it a fungal yeast? Is it a protozoan? Is it an algae? That's very huge groups. Remember, the fungi molds are filamentous. The fungi yeast are unicellular. There's one fella that's dimorphic, that flips between the two, with dye being the two and one being the shape. Remember who he was. Your two yeasts you need to know are Saccharomyces cerevisiae, they're listed on that review sheet, and the other one is Candida albicans. The bad guy is Candida albicans. Good guy is Saccharomyces cerevisiae, who's nicknamed the brewer's yeast. So, the dimorphic one is Candida albicans. A lot of your medical pathogens tend to be dimorphic. What does that mean? It means it can be filamentous, it can be yeast, it can be both on the same slide. Okay, coming back to a little bit more on this one. You know, I will ask for scientific name. If I ask for scientific name, that means Bacillus anthracis. That means the full name. If I say ping pong, of course that's it, Bacillus anthracis, the two parts. Some few of them, I may say you only need to give me ping, which means the first name, which means you'll give me Bacillus. Of the two, same back to Bacillus anthracis, the most important one is the first one. Because the second name can go with any organism in any group. For instance, you know there's an E. coli, right? There's an E. coli. There's also a Volantium coli, which is a protozoan. That second word in a scientific name has no meaning without the first. So if you just give me anthracis and don't give me bacillus, it's going to be all wrong, because that could still fit, well, not anthracis, but the last name could still fit somewhere else. If you have to have one of them, have the first. I'm hunting for tripping stones is what I'm doing. I'm going to look for tripping stones that other people have tripped over, so hopefully it won't happen to you. Okay, life groups. Let's just talk about bacteria, very small. Okay? You know that you're supposed to know the diseases. For instance, Bacillus anthracis is anthrax. Clostridium perfringens is gas, gangrene, and you know they are bacteria. Coming down to your fungal molds, you had only the two. Who is the black dandelion pup, but he could be colored any other color?
Aspergillus.
Aspergillus. And the other one that's fragile, that was the skeleton, is penicillin. We talked about the yeast. Protozoan. If it's huge and it moves by, it is a protozoan. If it's very still and doesn't move at all, it has a green color to it, it is an algae. Will you see a virus, please?
No.
Thank you. You cannot see a virus with a light compound scope. People put that down almost every year. They just like to see me jump up and down. It's okay. I mean, it's all right. Helps you get through. I'll be glad to jump up and down. Structures. If I ask for the life form, you don't tell me endospore. Okay? Because these are structurals like a finger or an arm or a toe. These are pieces of bacteria. capsule is that what halo that goes around your finger? Clear white halo that goes around the outside. Endospore and spore, a little bit of a tweak there. Endospore, and you can also, I will also accept spore, but that would be for bacteria. Survival or reproduction?
Survival.
If you have a bacillus with a clear area inside or any round area inside, it, there is no such thing as a bacillus swallowing a cocci. It doesn't exist. So what was the circular thing inside? It is a spore. Now, when you come to the fungi, again, you have spores, but those are reproductive, and they're not going to be inside the filament, so they're going to be the end of the fruiting body being released off into the air. You're not going to see them inside the hyphae fragments. They only come on the end of the fruiting body, the black dandelion puff, the skeletal hand. Then they break off and they go off through air and water. Yes?
Are those called canadiophores, or is that different?
One more time, please.
Are those called canadiophores? Like, would you want that?
If you want, if you think about the tree trunk and the dandelion head, that's a canadiophore.
We're going to
fine-tune it later. Because we're going to do an entire lab on the fungi, in which case that's not completely correct, but for him it's good enough. And I'm going to fine-tune it. You know, your layers of knowledge get deeper and deeper and more precise. So for now, it's good. Later, it's going to get more precise.
So for now, fruiting body is good?
Fruiting body gets you by right now. Because you haven't had the mycology lab, but for the future, we will have to know the word canadia for. Okay. You got to check that. Flagella are the things on the structures on the end, or paratrachus around the perimeter means goes all the way around. They're for what? What are they used for? Motility. So, if I ask for arrangement, don't tell me spores. Don't tell me mold. Tell me staph, strep, diplo, maybe filamentous, but don't put filamentous down for bacillus and thraces. Because bacillus and thraces is actually chains of bacilli. They are so close together, it's hard to tell. Staph means what? Clusters. Strep means chains. Diplo means two. Tetrad means four. Filamentous is just everywhere. Now, coming to your filamentous, you've had the moles, penicillin, and aspergillus. Their filaments are huge. They almost look like hollow straws. You also have a bacterium I want you to keep in mind called Streptomyces griseus. Streptomyces griseus. He is a bacterium under the group Actinomycetes. Remember that? His filaments do not look like big, huge, hollow straws. They look like a chaotic. Like somebody took a bunch of fine hair with some spores and threw it down in a glob. Very chaotic. But there'd be a hint on him because he produces what? Antibiotic streptomycin. You ever heard antibiotic streptomycin? Comes from Streptomyces griseus. If I say, what is the organism that gives us antibiotic streptomycin? You say, Streptomyces griseus. That's in your letter. So the filaments, if they're big and huge, push them to follow along. If they're so fine, they almost look like pieces of mint that have been taped together or fine hair. Push them to bacteria. You won't see hollow insides inside the bacteria. That's the disinterment. Now, what does morphology mean? That's how I looked at one. I said, what is morphology? I am asking for shape. Morph means shape. Go back to ancient Greek. Morpheus was a shape-changing character back in ancient Greek. So morph means shape. So this is a little bit on terminology. I don't want you to miss knowledge because the terms trip you off. That's not the goal. The goal is to help understand what you understand, not to confuse you with the terms. All right. Now, I'm going to go ahead and go to the projector. I'm going to do a mini lab review. I'm still going to give you about 20 minutes to go around, do the stations, ask me questions, let me get personal help. There's another lab review at 11:30. It'll be about the same, but you're welcome to come. Hold on, I'm going to turn this back on. worth a much, it used to be worth much more of your grade, like 30%. It has been reduced to 20%. But on the other hand, some people like this hands-on better. Everybody has different legalities of how they do it. Okay, I'm going to come back to this in a minute. This is part of your guides. Remember, if I have taught at Lambda, or I'm in this midterm review, I can still ask it. It's not, there's, it wasn't on the lab midterm review, you can't ask it. If I taught it, I can ask it. If it's in the lab manual, I can ask it. This is a focus to help you. It's not reteaching all the labs from beginning to end. Okay. Let's talk about this stuff. If you have, yes. If you have filaments that appear, look at that one. That looks more than you would see. Filaments that appear. And I tell you it can cause an illness, or actually you should, all should be able to recognize this one. Just like this. That's Bacillus anthracis. Remember, don't put filamentous bacteria because he's not. He is bacilli in chains. We have two spore formers. Who are two spore formers? Bacillus and Clostridium. So if you see a clear structure and his is centrally located inside, that has to be a spore. What is the illness? Anthrax. Used to be more of an issue, fever, people getting sick, etc., but there's cutaneous inhalation. For people with flies or hives, now it's a bioterrorist concern. Very much. Well, that's one of them. If that is Bacillus, who is the fella that has this big, huge spore on the terminal end about to fall off?
Clostridium tetanum.
Did I say tetanum? Clostridium is going to go for this one. They may get partial credit. Because I expect you to know why. He's the only one with
the spore on the end.
Spore swallowed on the very end. Now, if you have Clostridium perfringens, which is gastrointestinal, Clostridium difficile, C. diff, diarrhea. Clostridium.
I'm concerned you're blocking the people behind you. Can
y'all see? Yeah. She's fine. Right. No, I'll just check.
You're okay.
You're okay. They just said you're fine.
Okay.
All right. And Clostridium botulinum, which is botulism. Their spores are still there, but they tend to be subterminal, which means you probably have to have a clue on the card. Botulism, I'm pushing you toward food poisoning, especially with cans of puppy, or home canning mistakes, or maybe something got into the foods at a buffet. Clostridium perfringens, I said gas gangrene, Clostridium difficile, diarrhea. So those are your two spore forms. Gram positive versus gram negative. We get mostly gram positives, those are the ones we focused on. Staph and strep. Cocci are
positive.
Bacillus and Clostridium are gram positive. Now, you do have E. coli, you do have Pseudomonas, you do have Neisseria species that are gram negative. So don't forget those. Okay, what's the color for a gram positive organism?
Purple.
What's the color for a gram negative organism? Right. You can't tell me we're gram positive. I won't accept blue. I won't accept black. I won't accept some aquamarine. Okay? You gotta say purple. And that's the standard. Keep those in mind. Be able to recognize them. Be able to recognize them. Okay. Go back to another one. This is Bacillus both in tissue. What did I say about Bacillus in tissue? It can change its representation. So in tissue, you you have a bent rod, 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 you have a rod. First off, that's not a ground stain because they're not what? They're not purple. So that can't be a ground stain because they are ground positive. I'll have to tell you on a slide whether it's a ground stain. Now, they're no longer in filaments, they're in individual, individual cells. Individual cells. So we're going to stop there. Remember what yeast look like. Okay. Yeast, unicellular, and yes, they reproduce by budding, as someone said, you did a good job. If you have a small cell coming off a large cell, that's budding, the mother and daughter. Just to remind you about those hyphae, they go everywhere. And these would be the spore heads right here, 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 here. Of course, this is aspergillus. If you focus this up better like we had, you, they'd actually look like hollow gray straws. So don't forget that. Back to the latest information we had. This was the gram-positive cocci lab with one little side issue for Neisseria. I say what plate?
Blood.
Know your five plates. Tryptic soy auger for all your lab animals, PSA. Blood auger. Blood auger crystal violet. Manitol salts auger. Blood, what was it? Chocolate auger.
What was that?
Chocolate auger. Know whether they're selective differential, or if I ask a certain way, whether they're acting as selective differential. For instance, blood auger is not selective because it grows everything. There's nothing in there that stops it from growing. It's going to grow everything. Blood auger is where you're going to look for what? Lysis of hemolysis, lysis of red blood cells. The three types for what?
Alpha,
beta, gamma. Alpha means dirty green. But remember, if you have to reach for it, it is a no. If you have to reach to see it, you say no. On these plates, for instance, right here, you have the alpha, beta, and gamma. You can have a mix on everything, because the mixed culture is going to have mixed organisms and they're going to give you mixed results. So you will see a circle area indicated on the plate. Inside that circle will be what you look for, so you have focus. There's no point in trying to confuse people. So dirty green goes partial breakdown alpha, complete breakdown beta, and then nothing at all. Know the representatives I asked you to know from the lab. Give me 3-4 alpha.
Streptococcus pneumoniae.
Streptococcus pneumoniae in your lungs.
Streptococcus mitis.
Mitis in your mouth.
And streptococcus
mutans in your mouth. Mutans and pneumoniae often quite a while now. Okay, going to beta. Who were the two I asked you to know?
Streptococcus pyogenes.
Pyogenes, yes, that's strep throat. So Streptococcus pyogenes is one answer. And the other one is Streptococcus acalactiae. But that was back to someone's, do you know someone's wash his hands? That was purpureal fever. So you learned the first level way back when we first started with porcinolysis. Now you actually have an organism on a plate known as hemolysis. That's throwing all those labels back in the plate. It's still real. Okay. Now,
so what is blood auger? It's not selective, it's
differential because it tells the difference. Differential means to tell the difference by looking at it. It tells you the difference because of the hemolysis. Gamma. Gamma is no. Just plain old residents that don't hurt you are dairy strep, something from yogurt, something from cheese, not a problem in most cases. Is this completely true? Tell you that. Because there's an exception to everything. For what you have to learn, yes. Now that's differential, not selective. Now, this one actually should be both. I would have to slant the question as to whether you would answer selective or differential. In regard to selective, the name of it is mannitol salts auger. Salt is your hint. That's the thing to key in on your mind. For these organisms to grow on your skin, they have to be salt tolerant. So they're not the same level as in that ocean, because that ocean's a halo pond, lover of salt. These are just tolerating a little bit of a higher salt on our skin. Staff or strep?
Strep.
I'm staff.
Staff. Staff. Both staff. Now, you can't fuse the words. I have had people, just a heads up, they put strepalope staff. Okay? They just fuse it. I even had strephy. Okay? No. I'm not going to pick the right answer out from the soft from the whole. All right, back to that. Let's just give you a heads up. Staff. One will grow, and the strep will not. Okay, so Staphylococcus epidermidis was the name of your lab pet because it comes from your skin. Now, moving beyond that, if you had a sample from your nose, because those are both, that's pink, but if one turns it yellow, it's not Staphylococcus epidermidis, it's Staphylococcus aureus. So, still can be a harmless resident, can be, but can also be a flesh eater turning strep. And what is synovial fluid?
Joint fluid.
Fluid in your joints. What is sputum? Fluid from your lungs. Is sputum the same thing as saliva? No. Feces and diarrhea, I think we got that. Just had to, sometimes people don't know synovial, they don't know sputum. You did one test, or I did actually, and I have some examples here today so you can sure see it. If you had the yellow Staphylococcus aureus, another test to be sure it's Staph aureus is called a what test?
Coagulase.
Because think your body. It hides in your body, form a coagulated shield in itself and an abscess, and it's hiding from your what? Mucus. Hiding from your mucus. Later on, it'll break out from that degenerative point. So that was a little bit of rabbit plasma instead of that. It stays fluid like water, coagulates positive or negative. So not probably the staph aureus, but it's a sort of glitch. Does coagulate turn into a like clear molasses or a clear jello? That's coagulates positive, that is staph aureus. That's one of the three tests that are associated with the Cox aureus study. Coagulates. What was the one that you put on the plate, the TSA plate? That you can tell staph from a strep. That bubbles is a staph. That's the catalase test. Catalase, which is in your blood, you have it all through you. And you use hydrogen peroxide for probably. You take hydrogen peroxide, H2O2. If catalase is present, breaks hydrogen peroxide down into harmless water, and the bubbles are oxygen positive. Staph is catalase positive, strep is catalase negative. So if it bubbles, you've got staph. If it doesn't bubble, you've got strep. You can't run that with the test. Is why I had you do it on a TSA. You can't run it on any blood I look like on. Catalase is in the blood. Everything will come out
positive.
So if I have the mannitol sauce auger. Question. I said the flip plate for this one is blood auger crystal bottle.
Do we have to know mannitol salt auger?
Yes, you've got to be able to spell it out. So for MSA, mannitol salt auger, please refer to your lab name. TSA, triptic soy auger. BA, blood auger. CA, chocolate auger. Well, blood auger crystal valley, this is blood auger with the dye. Okay, so you should know that. And when we were teaching, I said, we've got your lab name. I am a little bit concerned, and I'm not going to go after anybody. You do a lot better if you have the lab name. Okay, but I understand the choices that people have to make sometimes, because I've been doing myself. Okay. All right. What is the one I say that's for selective reasons? Well, selective here means grows, staph, stops, strep. Differential means tells the difference between staph, epidermis, and staph, aureus, because it tells the difference. What's the other plate that is selective for strep that stops staph? Blood auger crystal valve. That plate is also differential because the strep will appear, will pick up the dye. Then if you're purple, the purple gray. All the other organisms in the world don't pick up the purplish purple gray. So that's blood auger crystal valve. There was a chocolate auger plate. You check the back of your throat. I did the oxidase test. This is little white tubes back there for you to see through. The colonies didn't change color. Did you have no serious species?
No.
You did, that the colonies turned blue and black. Maybe think bruises, blue black color. Right? Now, both of those plates, the blood out of the crystal ball from the throat, and also the chocolate out of the throat, will grow in this Campbell jar. Well, of course, no, that's the Campbell jar. So that's the obvious, it's a jar of Campbell in it. But what type of environment is inside? Microaerophilic. What does that mean? Means reduced oxygen, less than 20%, but mostly some other, well, CO2 in this case, environment. The Clostridium, however, would have been grown in what?
In
an anaerobic jar. That means no, well, it's the environment, you say anaerobic. Environment's anaerobic. But what that means, you say no what present? No oxygen present. So little plates. I think this from this part, we're going to go back to the review sheet. There's your sputum. Urethral pus would often be for Neisseria because it's the what, reproductive area. Then that be nice, that would be Neisseria gonorrhea, if you want to spell it out. That's not what's supposed to be in the back of your throat. That should be non-pathogenic, which means doesn't cause disease, regular resident, Neisseria. Okay, synovial fluid, Campbell jar we just talked about, anaerobic jar. Calculations. Don't forget how to do a basic calculation. Basic calculations. You may come up with probably a PowerPoint, and you're asked to tell me how many grams of something you need. This is going to be easy. I'm not going to make it up. In the stress the questions, three parts to each, everybody going around. It's going to have to be something basic. Okay, so the question would be, how many grams or how much powder do you need to make, say, TSA plates? I have two parts. The first part finds your what? Volume. The second part finds your grams of powder. I need to say media is actually more correct. Please don't tell me ounces, feet, gallons, something else. Please tell me grams. Now, volume is going to depend on you having to know the amount in the container, how many each student gets, and how many people in the class. You need those three things. So if you have a test tube, and each test tube has 5 meals, that's part of the employee that you have. If I see you need 2 tubes per student, you're going to have that input. And then I still have to tell you, because we talked about the class, the entire class. I'm going to say 20 people in the class. Now, this is going to be very basic, but I will be an all or none on this one, no partial credit. Because by the time I grade all of these and I give back to you, I can't get through all this. So, first, you take this into account. You go 2 times 5, means you need 10 meals of distilled water per student, right? Then you have to take this into account. So 10 times 20 means for the class you need 200 milliliters. And that's when you may have a visual, we'll go this way. You need 200 meals of what? Distilled water. You have to have this before you can go here. You have to have this. Now, you have one part that has to be told to you. It has to come off the what? Off the bottle. They say how many grams you're supposed to put per liter. You have to be given that. Because every bottle of media is different. And each one's set to give the right concentration. Let's say it says give 10 grams per 1 liter. Well, you set a ratio. You know right here that you have 10 grams, and you should catch me right here, for 1 liter, as something is to 200 mils. Can I do that? What doesn't match?
Those liters.
Gotta change it to?
1,000 milliliters.
1,000 milliliters. Because you can't have feet and inches. We don't have, you have to get all to the square inches. I'm gonna tell you to do what?
Cross multiply.
So becomes 1,000x is equal to 10 times 200. Okay, so do the math. Divide, wait a minute, why don't we divide by 1,000? That is essentially 1x, you're gonna divide each side. So x is equal to 2 grams. That is the answer. 2 grams of feet. 2 grams of feet. I am not out. If you just know the pattern, you're okay. The only thing I can change would be the amount in the container, the number of tubes per student, by the number of people in the class. That's the only thing that can change. Because the bottle's gotta stay the same. Well, not the same, it's gotta come from, that container. I'm gonna switch one. Okay, back to your graphs. Remember your graphs? So I'm gonna talk a little bit about graphs. You're not going to have to graph. You are going to have to be able to
read them.
Okay, read them and be able to label the axis. Read them and be able to label the axis. It don't make sense if you don't know what's on the x and y axis. Okay, let's start the first one first. We're going to say this is on semi-long paper. This isn't quite right because it's not semi-long paper. You come up to this and you see something like that. And the other thing you're going to have is time's going to be down here, because you have to know it's backwards and forwards, but that's the way. Time could be seconds, not that fast. Minutes, hours, days, sometimes weeks. This can be cell numbers per meal. Often it's like times 10 to something, say 6. At least in this area, and possibly in the central area. The goal I'm trying to go is, what am I going to ask? And your study says, what can she ask for this? I'm going to ask you the
generation
power. Well, what is the generation power?
Take the number, then double it, and subtract these 2 numbers.
Exactly right. It's the amount of time, which is what this really is, that lets your culture doubles its number. So you have to pick numbers that don't. Can I pick them here? Can I pick them here? Is it, I'm sorry, can I pick them here? Or do I pick them here? Pick in the law of base. I always pick the law of base. Pick 2 numbers that double. So I'm not going to draw a whole graph. I'm trying to get you the idea across right now. So if this is, say, 3, 4, 5, because it'd really be 3 cells per meal times 10 to the 6 would be the whole thing, okay? 6, 7, 8. Any 2 numbers that double. If I pick 4, I have to pick
8.
If I pick 3, I have to pick
6.
So, you're going to go over and drop down how many times? 2 times. So let's say we pick 4. Go over and do what? Hit. Then you go where? Straight down. And we're just going to say this is 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. So you pick that time, be sure you have your time, say this is in minutes. 30 minutes. Are you finished?
No.
Double of 4 is?
8.
So you have to go across it. And again, I'm straight, not drawn. And I'm straight down. Let's say that's about 43. 43 minutes minus 30 means the generation time is 13 minutes. Be sure you have the time and the correct number. Yes, there's a window. It's going to be a gracious window that if you're in there, it's somewhat close, you're okay. Over and over and over, I have people telling me 13 cells per meal. That's not what generation time is. That might be another graph, another question, but that is not related to, that's not the answer I want for generation time. Is everybody okay for this thought process? This pattern? Well, that's one thing I could have in front of you. I'm still talking about bacterial growth curve. You could also have something like this, where there's an A, or there's a B, or there's a C. Again, this is going to be cell number. Of course, you know per meal, but you know you have regions like times 10 to the 6 or times 10 to the 7, like that. Down here, for example, the time, I'm going to be asking you questions based on what? How flat or how much the slope rises in the wall phase. The basic core foundational information. The sharper the rise in that log, the happier the organism. The flatter that log rises, the lower the slope, the less happy that organism. So, if this was 37 degrees, this was 15, and this was 4 degrees, this organism would be a what? A mesophile. And it likes that temperature. It doesn't like fridge temperature very much. And the other ones, that there's 100,000 questions you can ask for this, but it's all based on sharp slope, high rise, happiest, flat, least happy. Okay? What if these were all the same organism? They're all organism A. And you treated this person, or this test in the lab with penicillin, maybe this one with tetracycline, and this with vancomycin. Which antibiotic that you want to give your patient?
Vancomycin.
This organism is sensitive, which means it's killed by vanco, but it is resistant to penicillin. So that makes sense. And it can be anything. It can be food that you add, temperatures, etc. Another graph, I'm trying to graph it there, but I'm trying to touch two things that you can. Remember the two to tell them apart. Be sure we're all on the same page, and be sure there's no glitches. I even had a handout for this. You have one with the slope going up, one with the slope going down. This is a standard curve to translate from the reading off machine to the scale of the what it stands for. Well, which one has the slope going up? Well, first, let's ask them two questions. This is based on the SPEC 20. The SPEC 20 measures the number of bacteria based on the concept called turbidity. That means what? The more hazy, more cloudy, the more cells, the less cells. The two types of turbidity are occlusivity, also called assortance, and percent transmission. And the whole goal is when you get this reading off machine is to translate these into what? Cell number. Well, if that's the whole goal, what is the bottom axis? Cell number per meal. Correct? Cell number per meal. That's your goal. You have drawn the best line through, or average it in your mind, through data points. Which one's which? That's the thought process. Optimal distance ordinance is how much light is absorbed. So the more light absorbed in means the higher the what?
Cell
number. So this number would have to be higher. This is your optimal. It's also called what? Absorbance. Because well, you can learn one and just know the other one's what? Opposite. Percent transmission is how much light gets through. So if you have a high cell number, isn't less light going to get through? So this would be percent transmission. Be able to label the axis, be able to, well, label the axis, know which one is occlusive percent transmission. If I give you a number like 0.05, how would you tell me the cell number? Go to that number, do what? Come across hit, do what? Drop down, or whatever that is, will give you your cell number. Please be sure you can see. I'm a little concerned about the seat. Okay, I'll be back. Don't worry, I'm making time to have some. Just try to cover everything I can for that. We did hemolysis. I said no if they're differential selective, no if they're here. Remember, our enterococcus is actually a type of streptococcus. Doesn't matter if it's fasciitis or fecalis, they're both like first cousins, you can be okay with that. But you just know enterococcus versus staph, you'd be okay for this part. You do need to be spell out staphylococcus epidermidis because it's on your skin and you're living with him. What are the parts of the strep? Remember the parts of the strep. One to here. Be able to label the parts of the strep. Don't forget those. So I can call out the page and find it. So I'm going to put it back in here. Page 2.5. I'll have it up on the front so you can find my copy of the group on my book. Maybe it's cool. Go down.
You want to use mine? I have it on my book.
Yes. Thank you. I need to find it as well. Appreciate it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 2.5. Coming back to this one. When you have a light source. You control the light source by two ways. There's a nozzle aside, just increases or decreases the light coming out. There is a lever in the front. There are two tripping stones on this that people almost always miss. That lever on the front that moves back and forth opens and closes the amount of light coming in. The full name for that is the iris diaphragm. Iris diaphragm. As long as I said your eye, it can open and close. It's very helpful to people. This, however, this little teeny piece of glass sunk into the center is called the substage condenser, because that's the stage, the platform's called the stage. It's sunk into a submarine, so it's substage, or subsurface, it's just below. Condenser means it's not magnifying, it's trying to keep the light going up into your eye, trying to keep the left of the light to the eyes. Keep that in mind. These, of course, have fine and coarse adjustment focuses. I'm not going to ask you about the electrical cord. I mean, really, you know that. You have objective lenses, but that's not going to be good enough for me. I want you to be able to make the magnification. You have 4X, you have 10X, you have 40X, and you have 45, and you have 100X. That's not the total magnification, that's the magnification on the nose piece objective lens. Other ocular lens, the ocular lens is the eyepiece. So that's what, 10x more, 10x more. So total magnification will be 4 times 10, 40. But if I ask you which objective lens it is, you don't want it 5 times 10, you just tell me what's on the objective lens that rotates, which is the old version. 100. Please know that. That's extremely important. Why? I gave you some numbers too for diameter and for tackles across. I'll show you how to estimate. Say 5 minutes, which is good because time is precious. Why did I ask you to memorize? Is that okay?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I need to stop if you need more light, let me know. Am I supposed to be okay? You're supposed to have memorized. Please know it's a 45 minute. That's just called light, okay? That's what that's called. That's just called light. I want you to know the diameter of a circle is defined as one side to the other across the center. So the diameter is also this way, that way. That's just your first idea. I didn't ask you to know what's in the lab manual. I asked you to learn 4,000, don't put feet.
Microns.
Microns. Please don't tell me there's a 27-foot bacterium working around this lab. We would have been eaten, I promise you. 400 microns. What ask is this going to be?
1,500.
and a higher field. So if I ask you, what's going to be the question? It's going to be to estimate.
Sorry.
Yep, estimate the size of it. Of course, you're going to take the long side. You have to know first your objective is. Then watch out, since your buildings may or may not line up across the equator, you have to sort of figure out whether they're halfway across, third way across, fourth way across. I'm just going to take this one for example. You have this one, and the organism stretched that way. And if you have a spirillum volutans, remember, spirillum volutans, he's a big, lazy, yes. Don't worry about spirillum, just the organism. And don't try to straighten them out and stretch them out and move them off. Just keep them where he is. It's all right. Just try to help people. Does about what? I guess maybe halfway. If all weight across is 400, he's going to be 200
microns.
Thank you for saying that. That'll be 200 foot bacteria. That'll be bad. He's probably not going to line up. He's probably going to be split on offsets there. Let's be ready for that. And I've said that. My goal is to teach you, not to try to trick you and find the most obscure thing I can ask you a question of. That's not. Coming back to this, okay, parts, estimate length, spec 20, ground staining. What's the order of ground staining?
Crystal violet,
iodine,
ethanol,
and ethanol. Note for the final two, because it is so important, because as soon as you do the ground staining, all bacteria drop into one of two groups. And it's so important. So the answer was crystal violet, iodine, ethanol, saffron. That's the order. And please sort of remember the ground staining procedure. You've got to do all of them. Okay, way back when, know what is your positive and negative stains. It's easier to know for lab, but this doesn't work completely in the real world. Our only two negative stains were Nigerson black and condo red. They stain the background. Everything else was everything else was simple stain, positive stain, stain the buildings. That's crystal violet, methylene blue, saffron, malachite green, they all stain the organism. Take it up a step. We did the spore stain. For the spore stain, know the shape of Fulton and the doorknob. A lot of you will recognize it. If you see little green dots with pink vegetative cell means a cell that eats and divides. That is, the green dots are what? As far as spores. The pink cells are just cells. The doorknob would have what color spores?
Black.
Red, black, except both. And the cells should be like a light gray, white, maybe a light. You know, the relative stains. If the spores are green in the shape of Fulton, you used malachite green. And then everything else came out pink. In that case, you used carbon. No, you used saffron. Moving to Dorner, you used carbon fuchsin to make the spores red to black. And to stain the background, for only one or two, but it was black, so it had to be the Nigerson black. One problem with micro, they use the word stain both for the dye and for the procedure. I've learned, because people, you know, I'm trying to watch and listen to people, they try to help pull that out. Because to use the same word for two different things means there needs to be some more clarification. Well, here it is, okay? Schaefer Fulton. What were the colors of the bacteria and spores, etc. We did coagulase test, we did oxidase, and we also forced the catalyst.
When it says spore stains, it says what bacteria did you see?
Well, in that case, you had Bacillus cereus and Bacillus cereus. Those were bacteria you saw. Bacillus cereus is the rice poisoner. Bacillus cereus is badly behaved and also not getting out of the lab. And it's just a tiny rod.
So Bacillus cereus and what?
Subtilis or subtilis? Okay, tripping stone, as a tripping stone. People understand what the coagulase test is. They understand what the coagulase test is, but they put the wrong word at the top. I even have people say, well, that means it takes hydrogen peroxide and breaks it down and you get water and oxygen, and they put what word? They put the wrong word at the top. That is catalase. Coagulase, maybe being in nursing and medical fields, was related to the coagulated blood. Let me get them into that. I'm trying not to put the wrong term over top, okay? Now, the same wheel, if people have done this more than a certain amount, I try to pull it out of the treatment stone. Now, you know, staff is strapped. Rim stain, know what a hyphae is? A hyphae means to say what? Hyphae means filling or hair. Okay. You know about anaerobic clostridium. You know Neisseria, like we already feel it. Don't forget your last three. People always forget the last three. Gram-positive, non-spore-forming rocks. Listeria monocytogenes. Coccobacillus. That means they can't decide what. Whether it's a coccus or a bacillus, they can hold it different each time. Key thoughts. Key in. Maybe sometimes write down like the words you want to know, or then key words around it. Concept line. Can grow in the fridge, crosses up the center, can harm and kill fetus. Can be in milk, meat, and can even live in life. That's great. And maybe we can, I don't want to do this, but I'll harm the life of the female.
No, I'm saying it's coccobacillus.
It's coccobacillus. That means they don't know which way it, they don't call it. It's all in twin. That's one of them. Who was the other one? This one has the following arrangements. These that result from snapping division. Palisades like hippopotamuses, and then chaotic like Chinese letters or ideograms, can form a very what in the back of the throat. So they put it in the back of the throat. The most unique symptom. The symptom that makes it stand out. So you
remember.
Pseudo membrane, false membrane, back of the throat. Do I know that term? If you ever see that, you've got what illness? You've got diphtheria, but the organism is Cronan bacterium diphtheria. It's a lab name. I'm not going to spell everything. One person said put Cori, like a guy, you know, that his name. And put in E. That helps me learn if that's okay. I mean it very nicely. I just found out that if I spell, I end up spelling for 20 minutes. That staph origin dot, staph is strep, no E. coli. There's the slides. We said aspergillus, bacillus and crisis. We left out Borrelia and treponema. There's treponema palatum. I went all the way out. Borrelia. I'll accept that right now, but next time you're going to have to know Borrelia boarded off the rock. Oxon? No. Bacilli? No. They are spirochetes. Remember, spirillum, big, lazy, yes, that's spirillum origin. So, like, somebody will study far as away.
That Borrelia?
Okay, spirillum gluteus is a spirillum. As in comparison, a tight core, a corkscrew, is a spirochete. The two spirochetes I ask you to know are Borrelia and Treponema palatum. They're also in the book. Which one is one? Borrelia is Lyme disease. That's one of the first ones you saw. It had the tangles and it had little tight corkscrews coming out. And then the vector is in what? Beautiful. You can see it. It can be in the backyard. It stays on you 24 or 36 hours. It can transmit the spot to you that you will have Lyme disease. It is in Florida. I have one student who was searching for help. And she was very fatigued. You get rheumatoid arthritis and go all the way to the point you can't remember your name, like neurological problems. So that's Lyme disease. Now, draw a line. Trepanillin palatum is not Lyme disease. It's not carried by tick. It doesn't come from a deer tick. It is a sexually transmitted disease. Syphilis. Syphilis has how many stages? 3. Primary rash, painless canker, point of infection. Goes in high. Spider keys are, you never get them. I never get a spider. Very good at hiding your body. There was one case where a gentleman, I think, okay, I'm just spiders. He was most of the problems. Okay, second time comes out a little bit more severe, hides in your body. Third time it's going to come out and destroy your major organs, including the heart and the brain. And the way micro goes is everybody that was crazy in history is they have syphilis. They say Genghis Khan has syphilis. They say George III has syphilis. They say Hitler has syphilis. Well, unless they have a tissue sample, they're just saying they were crazy because they had syphilis. That's what we don't want. There's your chronic bacteria right here. Okay. Don't forget that pseudomembrane. Listeria's monocytogenes, their sperm, the lutens. Remember that capsule. Streptococcus pneumonia with a capsule can make you sick. About it, it can not. There's your streptomyces griseus, but those hyphae are not the huge, like, clear ones. They're more like grass or splinters. Don't forget your yeast. That's pretty much this part of what I added to it. I'm going to turn the lights back on, so please prepare your eyes. It's going to be bright. Okay. What I'd like to do now is I always like to be interactive. And not just lecture you until you're about to slide into the floor and fall asleep. Let you ask questions. Before I do that, what happens if you want to touch any of these plates or tubes? You have to put on gloves. Here's a staph and a strep, opaque versus translucent. Who is supposed to be opaque? Higher numbers.
Staph.
Who's more fastidious, picky eater?
Strep.
So he's translucent. Okay? There's some other plates up here you can look at. Remember the gray, the purple means strep, the blood on crystal violet. There's some questions around here and some chances. So we're going to walk into the questions for the first time tomorrow. Just some practice questions. I'm not trying to keep it secret. I won't tell you the answer. So I just want you to try it first, though, before giving the answer, because it helps your mind think that way. There's a scope over here, some tests over here, another plate. Some slides are out you can pick up at your wheel. After pulling slides out, you won't. This, you'll get a chance to see, so I'm going to show it to you. This was the what test?
Cronan.
That is positive. This is like a clear gel. So this indicates staph aureus. Again, everything is sealed with your body's smoke and blood. This is liquid in the bee, so that's a negative. But if it's like clear molasses, and it sort of moves around, that is positive. That's positive versus negative. And before I release you, so I can also look through my questions, is there any component or portion that you'd like for me to go over? Talk about, I should cover, before I either, and remember, I'll still answer your question privately too. It doesn't have to be in front of everybody. So that way people can still have privacy in the room. Any questions? Okay, then look at the stations. I will pull any slide you want. I will answer any question one-on-one and privately teach you one-on-one. And I will help every way I can. What happens tomorrow? One quick point. I know y'all will do this. I had a sign one time posted up over the lab handle that said, do not enter. I came in and 4 people were sitting there. Okay? So please bear with me until I let you in, because I'll probably be finishing up vaccinations. And at that time, a sign, you know, there's no sign this time. So they're like, no, that's a completely different thing. Don't come in if there's a sign that says, do not come in. They had to lift it up to get to the handle again, and they said they didn't see it. So, whatever. Okay, again at 11:30, let me answer questions. Let me help.